the Snapmaker U1, a four-headed 270mm tool changer that as of today, you can pick up during their Kickstarter for an early bird price of, wait for it, just $749. So in this video, I'm going to show you what it has, what it's capable of, how they've achieved such a low, low price, and why, ultimately, I think this 3D printer is an absolute game changer. Let's get after it. First things first, as always, let's go ahead and get the ethical stuff out of the way because it's important. This video is not a review. It's a sponsored first look and a first look at a pre-production Kickstarter at that. Of course, my opinions cannot be bought and I would never say anything that I don't feel to be true. Also, to Snapmaker's credit, they actually encouraged me to share my feedback, both positive and negative. Still, ethically, because money has changed hands, there are a lot of things that I can't say in a video like this. I can't, for example, say that this is already becoming my absolute favorite 3D printer of all time, or that I genuinely think that it's worth twice what they're asking for. And I definitely can't say that I'm actually fearful for some of the other companies in the consumer 3D printing industry now that Snapmaker has introduced this printer at this price. No, I could never say those things in a sponsored video, but I can show you why, sponsored video or not, I think they just might be true. So why don't we do this? Throughout this video, I'll show you just what this printer has and what it's capable of, and I'll try my best to keep my commentary to an absolute minimum. Then all of you can tell me in the comments below what you think of it. Is this printer a compromised low budget attempt at a tool changer, or is it a market breaking paradigm shift that should honestly cost twice as much as it does? Sound like a deal? Okay, here we go. First, and really quickly, let's talk about the specs and the hardware. I normally wouldn't bore you guys with all of this, but there are a few very interesting things that I do think I should cover. And I guess you can skip ahead if it doesn't interest you or you've already seen this information in Snapmaker's own marketing materials. For build volume, you're looking at 270mm³ and a bed that reaches 100 degrees C. Obviously, we've got four automatically aligning independent tool heads, each capable of 300 C with stainless steel quick swappable nozzles, though my review unit also has DLC coating, so I presume they're already well on their way towards releasing hardened steel version. Filament loading is made easy by these handy little automated loaders on the side, which is a welcome departure from other tool changers on the market. For firmware, we get a very nicely skinned version of Clipper with plans to publish in accordance with the open source license requirements. You can even access the fluid interface if you prefer, at least on my review unit, via LAN mode. For a slicer, we've got Snapmaker Orca, which unlike a lot of skinned versions of slicers, actually has some new logic and interface stuff added to accommodate the tool changer, but get this, those changes are already integrated into the nightly builds of mainline Orca Slicer, including the ability to print directly from the slicer and monitor that custom interface remotely, which, as far as compatibility, puts this printer ahead of basically the entire industry, including Bambu Lab, Prusa, Creality, and almost everyone else. Finally, as you probably observe, this printer is currently open on top, but it has an expansion port for an upcoming top hat style cover, which I'm hoping will be both actively heated and filtered for printing engineering grade materials. All right, tech specs out of the way, let's get to printing. Rules are rules, so the first thing I printed was this four-color Benchy, which took 2 hours and 35 minutes. It looks fine, but this isn't all that interesting or impressive, so let's move on. Sorry. For my second print, I decided to really push this printer. Snapmaker gave me all kinds of disclaimers about things not being finalized, pre-production, blah, blah, blah. So I wanted to see where the limits were. I loaded up three of this really cool Wolverine DeadPool model from Serif 3D, which given the talons and the katana is clearly much more suited for resin printing. And I hit print. I expected a lot of things to happen, but a completed print wasn't one of them. In fact, during this print, the construction company working across the street actually knocked out the entire city block's electricity for like 5 hours, and you can actually see the tiny little line or shift where that happened right here. But given that the power outage happened while the printhead was literally on the model, I'm actually kind of shocked that this print was able to recover and that the end product is even passable. Yes, the purge block did detach in the middle, as did one of the models towards the end of the print. But if I'm completely honest, I definitely didn't clean the build plate during assembly and I got my fingers all over it, so that's probably on me. But, look at the results. I promised to keep my commentary to a minimum given my biases, so I'll just point out that automatic supports on the talons and the sword really didn't cut it, but I wasn't expecting them to, and that there is some support material that fused to the bottom of the model. That wouldn't be noticeable if it was all the same color, but because we're changing color, it is. So in the future, if I don't need all four colors, I'm going to go ahead and set one of the tools to a breakaway support material and use that at least for the support interfaces. To try that out, let's go ahead and take another model which is very clearly designed for resin, but which only needs two or three colors. I chose this awesome Squid Game Soldier collaboration by Fotis Mint and Wexter. Just have a look at these details, plus the difficulty of the tool changes on such tiny little details when I painted things like the buttons. Let's see what happens. Damn. I didn't think that this would work this well. I think maybe Snapmaker may have undersold this machine. The breakaway support filament did a perfect job, leaving absolutely no marks or scarring. The details on the mask came out almost perfectly. You can even make out some of the detailed texture from the canvas jumpsuit. No VFAs, just perfect extrusion, and the areas where you see the color bleeding and not perfect, that's because my painting job wasn't perfect, and the printer accurately reproduced that. But I mean, come on, right? PLA is easy. Any multiplexer can do this if you're patient enough. What about true multi-material printing? To test that out, I recently designed this camera grip, and I want to try printing it out on the U1. I already printed one out on the Prusa XL, but the PETG-CF that I used is just too flexible. So instead, I'm gonna go ahead and load up some PolyMaker Polysonic Pro PLA, which should be very rigid, as well as some PolyMaker 95 TPU, and give it a go. Now, side note, I've had some issues with Snapmaker extruders and TPU filament in the past, so I really wasn't sure what to expect. For example, I bet that the automatic filament loading system just won't work with TPU, and I'm gonna need to load TPU through some janky bypass in the back.
No way. Huh. Wow, that worked.
Okay, well, I bet it's gonna under-extrude. Damn, okay. So the finished product looks almost perfect. There is some stringing on the TPU that got caught in between the layers of the PLA, but I have a feeling that that was due to the filament soaking up water during the print, so it might be best to print directly from a filament dryer for certain types of filament. The end result looks and functions beautifully. I'll go ahead and share a link to my design in the descriptions if you want to download it. So it can do multi-material printing and pretty stuff. But how about some more engineering grade filament? Okay, yeah, this is pretty impressive. Honestly, I think this is one of the nicest 3D printed parts I've ever seen. This is, funny enough, a part for my Prusa XL, which combines Atomic Filaments PETG-CF with Prusa Mint PETG. Profiles for the U1 are still very limited. They promise to release many more before it ships, so I actually had to make my own profile for the PETG-CF, and I was kind of expecting the first print to be a mess. But yeah, it's perfect. And for those of you thinking, wait, Jonathan, have you finally changed your mind about PETG? No, I still hate PETG and I think it's the devil's creation. But PETG-CF is the exception, and I love it, and every rule needs at least one exception. So far, however, I haven't found an exception to the rule of very, very impressive prints coming off the U1. And frankly, I'm not used to not breaking pre-production printers during my testing, so let's crank up the difficulty to 11 with a 21-hour print that I'm pretty sure is gonna fit. Guys, what are we even doing here? Like, do you really expect me to pretend that this isn't insanely impressive? Okay, so first of all, ignore the kind of color bleed on the top of the models because that's actually caused by transparency in the filament, kind of like a hue forge. I tried printing these at 0.1 millimeter layer heights because of the curvy organic shapes of these cars. Also, I thought that maybe this was a mistake and that the printer bled colors here and here. But when I went back, I found out that actually I missed a spot while painting and the printer just faithfully reproduced it. So these two kit cards by the kit card guy as sliced were supposed to take just under 22 hours. They ended up taking 27, I guess because the slicer doesn't yet know the accurate tool changer times, but still, I compared that to the smart filament grouping setting on the $2,400 Bambu Lab H2D, and the U1 was still 15 hours, or around 55% faster. Not to mention, the H2D would have wasted 93% more filament, basically twice as much in the process, resulting in the end print costing a whole $6.30 more. Now, compare it to the single nozzle Creality K2 Plus, which I don't think is accurately predicting the print times, and with the same settings, you're looking at an additional 400 plus grams of filament wasted for a total of $15 literally thrown in the trash for just these two models. With numbers like these, it is quite easy to see how this printer could pay for itself if you plan on doing a lot of multicolor printing. Anyways, for this print, I actually just left the printer running over the weekend while I went up north to my in-laws, which is honestly a level of trust reserved for a very select few machines in my farm. And the only issue it had was, once again, a slight amount of bed adhesion issue on one of the pretty difficult parts, the tire. To be fair, I don't think I ever actually did get around to cleaning the build plate, but after this, I just applied Magigoo and that resolved any future bed adhesion issues. And I mean, what can I say? If you ignore those filament transparency issues and the ugly layer lines caused by the crazy organic shapes of these sports cars, these are two seriously impressive 3D prints, completed in 2/3 of the time, using half as much filament on a printer that costs 1/3 as much as the industry flagship. I'd be lying to you and to myself if I tried to act all nonchalant. But can it do it reliably? I mean, sure, it's nice to be able to pull this off once, but now that I'm crossing 50 plus hours and thousands of tool changes, can it actually hold up, or was this just a Okay, seriously, this printer has blown my mind. Look at this SKULLDroid print by Pipecox. 16 hours, 2 power outages, no hiccups, not one missed tool change, not one shifted layer. The parts fit together perfectly, and the gears mesh just fine. Like, am I out of line here? This is absolutely insane. This printer costs $749 during the early bird phase of the Kickstarter, but even the MSRP is just $999. Like, how am I supposed to be objective about this? What do you guys want me to do? You want me to try and give some criticisms for the sake of making a balanced video? Sure, all right, cool. Here we go. First and foremost, Snapmaker's new cloud service still isn't scaled up. It's still a little bit slow and buggy. It logs me out of the slicer every time I close it, and I can't reliably print from the cloud. But then again, Snapmaker is unique in that they actually let me run this thing in LAN mode and directly access the fluid interface. So I've just been uploading and downloading stuff like G-code and time lapses through that. The automatic filament extrusion calibration takes like a really long time for each one of the filaments. I guess that's kind of annoying. Okay, here's one. These plastic panels up top, they feel pretty cheap, and the clips are a little bit loose. There's no handle to lift the printer up. That's a real criticism. Oh, and I guess like the white plastic smudges easily. But then again, would I rather this printer cost $100 more and be made out of aluminum panels instead? Probably not. Okay, here. This is a real criticism. I really would have liked if each of the tool heads could have reached 320C or even 350 like the K2 Plus. And in my opinion, 120C on the build plate would make this printer much more future-proof for engineering grade materials. But I think you can actually print even PETG-CF at 300 and 100, especially if you use something like Majigoo's PA product on the build surface. And if the top hat cover thing upgrade allows this printer to reach high enough internal chambers, you actually probably should still be able to print any filament. All right, one last one. Four tool heads. Maybe I'm spoiled by the Prusa XL, but I routinely found myself wishing for a fifth tool head, either for breakaway support material or because so many multicolor models are designed around the Prusa and Bambu multicolor ecosystems, which can have 5 to 16 colors. Though I was thinking about it, and I don't see why you couldn't build in some logic for the splicer to prompt the user to manually swap out one of the filaments in one of the tool heads midway. For example, you could specify a certain layer, like right here, where you no longer need the white, but you then want to switch to red, like for these taillights. Till then, a little bit of paint will easily solve that issue. And personally, I'm hoping that if this machine, the U1, is a commercial success, Snapmaker will follow it up with a 350 by 350 millimeter, 5 or 6 tool-headed U2, or U1 Max. On that note, let's talk about the purchasing situation, because this is a Kickstarter printer, albeit from an established company with a track record of actually delivering products. Right now, you can pick up the Snapmaker U1 for the way too low price of $749 for early bird backers, with an estimated ship date of this. I'm actually recording before that has been finalized. If you'd rather wait until the units are actually shipping, it'll set you back a still too low for what you're getting, $999. Look, I've tried to be as objective as possible in this video, but I think the results speak for themselves. And I've been in contact with other people who are doing actual unbiased reviews of this machine, and we're all blown away. I mean, I literally didn't have a single print failure outside of those caused by a dirty bed. And the circumstances were very much stacked against me. Like I said, this isn't a review, and there is certainly the possibility that the pre-production unit I got was somehow cherry-picked or better made than the production unit you'll eventually get. But it's my personal opinion, based on my experience, that even at twice the Kickstarter early bird price, this machine would still be an absolute bargain. And I would not hesitate to recommend it to anyone looking to do a lot of multicolor or multi-material 3D printing. But hey, I'd love to hear in the comments below. Did I step out of line and let my bias get the best of me? Or do you agree that this printer is objectively a massive disruption to the current 3D printer market? Whether this printer's production version remains as reliable long-term, or whether the U1 truly shakes up the market like I predict, only time will tell. But from where I'm standing, I cannot deny that this is the most impressive product to come across my test bench in years. That's all for this week, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.